Hi everybody, Rob here from State of Art Academy. Welcome back to the Autodesk 3D Max 2015 Essential Training. Today, we're going to start with the interface. If this is the first time you see the software, the interface could be a little bit scary. There's a lot of toolbars, menus, buttons, and it's not really user-friendly, so we're going to split it in smaller parts. First of all, in the top left corner, we can find the File button, the one with the 3D Max logo on it. Like in every software, this menu can let us create new files, open old files, save them, even save just part of them in a brand new scene with the Save Selected option. We can create archives, which are basically zip files with inside all the scene content, even textures from your hard drive. Then we have the import options, and be careful because there is a little bit difference between the import and the merge options. The import is useful when you have to import non-native formats like OBJ. On the other hand, the merge works with the native .max files. Export lets us to save the file or part of it into a non-native format file. Send to is a pretty new option we can use to directly connect with other Autodesk softwares. Then we have references options, useful when you need to work with XREF, externally referenced objects. The asset tracking is something you really use a lot. It's an easy way to check and correct every file path or link of your scene. The manage tool lets us to set the project folder you want to work within. The properties tools give us some information about the scene and let us write some metadata of the file. Again, on the top left corner, we can find the quick access toolbar with some of the most common buttons like new, open, save, undo, redo, and set project folder. Like everything in the interface, even this toolbar is customizable with your own favorite buttons. Under the Quick Access toolbar, we find the menu bar, a series of drop-down menus with all the main functions of 3D Max. Under it, we find the main toolbar. Every button here is quite important and it's good to spend two more words about the most useful of them. Starting from the left, we have Undo, Redo, Ctrl-Z, Ctrl-Y on the keyboard if you want to start learning some shortcuts, and you want to. The Selection Filter drop-down menu, really handy when you want to select just some type of content. Then, we have the Selection Tool, Q on the keyboard. The Select by Name, useful when you have to select different objects with a similar name or just find the right one in the middle of the crowded scene. This means you have to rename properly every object, and we will speak about that later. On the right, we can change the selection shape, keep pressing Q on the keyboard to switch between shapes, and the window crossing toggle. By default, remember, you can select an object just touching it with the selection. After it, we find the Move, Rotate, and Scale tools. You can use them directly on an object or entering a value, clicking on them with the right mouse button. Shortcuts are W, E, and R. With R, you can cycle through different types of scaling. And I have to tell you, scaling an object with these tools is never a good idea, and you will see why. A brand new tool is the Select and Place, letting us to move an object along a surface in no time. Then we have the Referency Coordinate System drop-down menu, where we can basically change the pivot position of the selection. Let's jump to the snap toggles. The first works for movements and the second one works on rotations. The snap toggle could work in three different ways and I personally use the three-dimensional one. If you right-click on it, you can change the type of element you want to snap on. Check if you have Use Axis Constraints on, otherwise your object will not move on the chosen axis. It's common to set these on Vertex. In the Angle Snap toggle, again, right-click, you can change the amount of degrees you want to snap to. Then we have two buttons for the creation and management of named selection set, the mirror and align tools, the manage layer tool, material editor, render setup, render frame window, and the render button. If you click on the toggle ribbon button, you can switch on and off the ribbon menu. In this menu, you can find some useful tool to create and modify object. Now, most of the options are not visible because they work if you have an editable poly selected. On the right, we have the command panel. It's really huge. There's a lot of different tabs for the creation of geometry, shapes, lights, cameras, and other stuff. We can even modify objects, we can add modifier in the second tab, we can play with the pivot, there's a bunch of options about what you want to see or not to see in the viewport, and so on. We will learn about these in the third part of the tutorial. At the bottom we have the lower interface bar with the timeline, animation commands, and viewport options. Sometimes you will need to change and customize the user interface, probably because you have just installed a new software like V-Ray, or you don't like some colors like the background of the viewport, or you want just change some shortcut. The thing you need to do is to go here, customize, customize user interface, and then you will see this pop-up. There is a lot of tabs. In the first two tabs, you can change the shortcut of the mouse and of the keyboard. And then you can add some features in the toolbars, quads, and menus. And you can even change the colors. For example, I don't like the bright background of the viewport, so I will change. Here we are in the right section. I will go down and search for viewport background, and can easily change the color from here. I will put a darker one. And after you change it, you can apply them, and after a few flashes, you will see, yes, here we are, darker background. I prefer it. Another example, in the menus, I want to add, for example, in the Tools menu, under the Light Lister, which is the default one from 3D Max, the V-Ray version of it, so I will go down into categories, I will search for V-Ray, here we are, and then here we have the V-Ray Light Lister. So with a simple drag and drop, I can put it here and save the interface. And then when we close it, we will find the V-Ray Light Lister here in the Tools menu. 3D Max gives us four different viewports, one for the top view, one for the front, one for the side, and one for the perspective. You can select one viewport by clicking in it, and you will see the frame turning yellow. Now, you can fully customize each viewport by clicking on these three labels here on the top left corner. The plus stands for general viewport. You can find some general option, even the configure viewport, which allow you to change the layout and the number of the viewport inside the canvas. The second one is the point of view. You can change the point of view from perspective or to orthographic top, bottom, whatever you want, or you can use shortcut from the keyboard. T for the top view, P for the perspective, F for the front, and so on. If you go back to the perspective, for example, with the P, and you want to zoom in, you need to press Z on the keyboard, and you will zoom on the selected object. If you don't have any object, you will zoom on the grid. If you want to hide or unhide the grid, the button on the keyboard is the G. Now I want to show you the last panel here, the shading viewport, but I want to maximize the viewport before that, the perspective one with Alt W. As you can see now it's full screen and I have to create something in the scene like a teapot. That's good. And one simple standard target spotlight. As you can see, we can see the preview of this light on the viewport on the teapot because we are in shaded mode. If we change to realistic and we go here, lighting and shadow, and we change to illuminate with scene light, you will see the preview of the spotlight on the objects. Now some usable shortcuts. With F2 you can see the preview of the selected face, fill it with a red color. With F3 you can go in wireframe mode, and with F4 you can go in edit faces mode. Now I just personally work in 3D Max with one viewport, the perspective one, and I maximize it with Alt W. I force myself to work with Alt button and the middle mouse to orbit around objects to see if I have problems, mistakes, etc. etc. If you select one object, that object will become the pivot of the orbit, so you will rotate around it. On the top right corner, we find by default the Viewcube. This feature comes from Maya and allows us to navigate around the scene in a very simple way. You just need to click on the side of the cube you want to see, and 3D Max will rotate a point of view with a smooth transition. If you want, clicking on it with the right mouse button, we can change the settings, dimension, opacity when you don't use it. We can even choose to feed the camera on the object every time we use it. If you are not a fan of the Viewcube, you can easily switch it off and go along with Alt plus middle mouse for orbit around object, middle mouse to pan, and scrolling with the mouse wheel for zoom and unzoom. You can open the quad menus right clicking on the viewport area. The available options in the quad menus depend on the current selection. For example, if we select an editable poly, we will be able to enter the face selection mode. If we do the same with the editable spline, we can go in the vertex, edge mode, etc. If we select the source of a light, with the quad menus we can easily select the target of it. Again, with the standard camera, we can choose to straighten up the vertical lines, adding a camera correction modifier. More than this, in the quad menus, we can find some useful functions, like isolate selection, Alt Q on the keyboard, hide and unhide objects, freeze and unfreeze objects, transformation and conversion tools, object and V-Ray properties panels.